So may the Lord bless you.
Amen.
Can we stand? And read Revelation 3. Revelation chapter 3. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. How would thou wert cold or hot? So then, because thou art lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods, and have needs of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou may be rich, and white raiment in the thou may be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the grace. We thank you for this time. We thank you for this day. Lord, it's a great privilege for us to be here and be able to hear your word. Many people, Lord, at this time, some are sick. They can't even go and hear your word. Some have abandoned the faith. Some, they don't even know you. But to know you in this hour of confusion, it's only your grace. Be blessed for that. Lead us once more today. Open our understanding, Lord, so that at the end, the glory and honor may be given to you. Speak to us, Lord, personally, individually, in a way that we will become concerned. We will become engaged with you. We will walk for you. We will serve you, Lord, with all our heart, all our mind, all our strength, for we know there is no more time. Your return is so near. Signs around speak volume. Lord, grant it. For we have prayed in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
And God bless you, Brother Daddy, to have you in our midst. So, we were talking about our age, the church of Laodicea. This is the last age, which is a very, very difficult age. Very difficult because the enemy is no longer outside. The enemy is inside. And the Lord who's meant to be inside, the Lord is outside. It's a contrast. you would expect the owner of the house to be inside his house, but in this picture that we have, the Lord is outside and the enemy is inside. Many gatherings today, religious gatherings, we may look at them with natural eyes and think, but brother, what's wrong with it? They preach the word. They read the word. They read the Bible. They worship God. But when God looks at them, they don't worship Him. The Apostle Paul, in his time, he wrote in 2 Corinthians and said, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, speaking of the blindness, Second Corinthians 4, from verse 4, it says, maybe verse 3, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. So there are people, the God of this world has blinded them. They can hear the word, they can see things, but they can't understand them. They think everything is all right. But what they don't realize is the God of this world. Because in the world, there is what we call the prince of the air, the devil. He has confused the people in many ways. He has twisted the word. He has confused marriage. Instead of a man marrying a man goes after a man, a woman goes after a woman. It is a total confusion. And people think everything is all right. But the Bible says the God of this world has blinded them. Even if you show them in the word, still they will not believe. That's why this church, the Laodicean church, it can boast of the meanings. I have need of nothing. And yet when God looks at the church, God sees that this church really needs help. It really needs help. There are people who think, brother, I've got money. Everything is alright. I don't need you. I will tell you, brethren, money cannot buy everything. When you fall ill, you will then see the limitations of your money. Because money cannot buy you healing. There are diseases that money cannot just put an end to. Unless God does something. Divine healing is a miracle in itself. It's an act. Brother, how can you explain a blind to be blind naturally is not a disease. There are people who are born blind. They don't feel pain in their eye. The only thing they don't have is the sight. And God opened their eyes. But how possible? It's because God is the creator. God can restore the sight in a second. But this church, the church in which we live, brothers, the one who lifts up a person, it's God himself. The one who can bring you down, it's God himself. When you are up, be mindful. Don't become puffed up. Don't become so proud in a way that you start feeling as if you are untouchable. You've already reached the roof. Not at all, brother. We need to serve God in humbleness. Humbleness of spirit, humbleness of heart. We are nothing. We are really nothing. I met one brother over the weekend. I'd heard many things about him. Oh, the brother's fallen, the brother's done this and that. And then I took a phone, I rang him several times. He wouldn't pick the phone. He was avoiding answering, and I left messages. He wouldn't call me back. I said, fine. Then it happened, we met. When I approached him, he couldn't come closer. I said, brother, come over. Come hug me. And then I hugged him. I said, but why didn't you pick the phone? He said, brother, I was ashamed. I said, don't be ashamed. He said, no, brother, I've let you down. I said, brother, don't be ashamed. And then we started praying. He really cried. And then at the end, he said to me, brother, I'm so surprised that you've come to me. I said, but brother, don't forget. What has happened to you is the devil. You did not pay attention to the warning. Because in this message, brothers, if there are people who have been warned, we are the ones. Judgment, God will never take you into judgment without warning you. Many, many years ago, especially when we used to get in Nottingham, we used to preach, brother, if you want to go and visit a sister, have somebody with you. Sister, if you want to go and visit a brother, have somebody with you. For your own safety. You may have good intentions. You go there maybe to just help out, or maybe to do something that will not last long. Then yes, brother, it was not easy. People opposed the seriously. What kind of a gospel is this? Why are you always suspicious? What do you think? Or do you think people will fall? Brothers, we nearly changed it. Say, okay, fine. But people who oppose that, most of them, time came we had to sit down on the table and start talking about it. And asking one another, what has happened? Brother Branham is the one who said it. Brother Branham said, when a woman called me, brother, I'm sick, I'm in a hotel, I will take Billy Paul or I will take my wife. Because when I walk in, if somebody sees me walking out, he will say, we saw him coming out. How will I go and explain it? I will have nothing to explain. And even if I go and explain, who will believe you? Because you are a preacher, they will say, we saw him. He was in a hotel with a woman. But that is not applicable just to a preacher. These are things, my brethren. It's not like we are warning you not to talk to a sister. No. They will help you. They will really help you. Because your testimony, we want it to remain spotless. We don't want to sit here one day and hear a brother or a sister has fallen in sin. Because it hurts. It really hurts. We will never sit here and rejoice because a brother or sister has fallen in sin. No. Your loss is our loss. When you lose a battle, all of us will be affected. Brethren, I told that brother, I really cried a lot. I wish it never happened, but it has happened. Let's move on. Let's fight. Let's carry on. But the attitude of people is what really surprised me. Brother, we are living in an age, you need to be very careful. Very, very careful. Why? Because the enemy is watching you. The enemy is roaring around like a lion. You make a blunder, you expect people to come and lift you up, they're going to plunge you deeper in a ditch. That's the problem with Laodicea. Laodicea has lost completely the guidance, the direction. Brothers, people who could come and cry with you, they are no longer there. People are quick to laugh at you. Ah, you see now. You see now. Brothers, David, when Saul was killed in the battle, David could not rejoice because David knew Saul was anointed by God. Why should I rejoice? David even made a song and said, don't go and tell the Philistines that Saul has died because they will rejoice. If a brother falls in sin, we don't encourage sin, but it hurts. We're going to cry until we make sure the man stands up and moves on. But it's no longer the case. Laodicea has been blinded to spiritual matters. The only thing that comes in the heart of Laodicea is the pleasures. But I've written a few scriptures on blindness. Look what the Bible says. If you read in Isaiah 6, the Bible says here, Isaiah 6, I read from verse 8. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. And he said, go and tell these people, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of these people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert, and be healed. Then said I, Lord, how long? In the French, the Bible, the question is, Lord, but for how long? And he answered, until the cities be wasted without inhabitants, and the houses without men, and the land be utterly desolate. And the Lord have removed the men far away, and they be a great forsaking in the midst of the land. But yet, in it shall be a tent, and it shall return, and shall be eaten, as a tame tree, and as an oak, whose substance is in them when they cast their leaves, so the holy seed shall be the substance thereof. Amen.
Amen.
Brothers, there is something mysterious that is going on. I really want you to understand, we are not dealing with carnal things. We are dealing with spiritual things. We sit with you, we all hear the word. They preach the word. We are all in the same church. We hear the word. But that word makes you to see. It makes you to understand. The same word leads you to repentance. You repent of your sin. But to the other person, it doesn't do anything. Instead, it makes him or her upset. Then you wonder, but how? The Lord said to Isaiah, go and tell these people. When you go, go and preach unto them. They will hear, they will see, but they will not understand. The Lord said to the Pharisees, why are you not able to understand my language? There are things, they are happening, you think it's just a joke. Meanwhile, there are spiritual matters, very serious spiritual matters. Your final destiny depends on how you understand the word and how you discern what you are hearing. Otherwise, you're going to miss the goal. Jesus said, the one who will dip his finger in my plate, that's the one who will betray me. Judah was there, but he was like in a dream. He's there. Maybe he might have even said, amen. And then after a few seconds, he then went and dipped his finger in there. Why? Because the word in itself is a spirit. The Lord has to reveal it to you. Otherwise, brothers, you're going to leave the Lord here. You go and look for the Lord in a denomination. How many message believers? 20 years in the message. As Brother Justin told us of his friend who believed at the same time with him. They were very zealous for the word. But just now when he went home, the man is one of the biggest Methodist preachers. Then you question, but how? How did it happen? There was a sister by then when we were in South Africa. I always remember I knew her husband very well. By then, she had already spent 13 years in the message. When we came in Europe a few months after, we let know that sister. She's now one of the prophetess in the church of Mama Olangi. A woman is a preacher, and that sister has become a prophetess. Then you see there, brother, you are wondering, but how? What kind of a shift? Brethren, you may think in this journey everybody understands. It's not the case. If the Lord does not open your understanding, you will never understand. It's not about English. It's not about English. Brother, me, I understand English very well. If it was about English, all the English people could have just read the Bible and understand exactly what the Lord has said there. Because then, it is their language. They can read in their language. Oh, brother, do you know what? I've read it in English. And I've understood it well. Why? Because it is well understood in my own language. But it's not about English. The Lord has to open your understanding. You are there. Things are taking place, but you don't understand. And then you are wondering, but what is going on? Brethren, in the word, there is life. If the life of the word comes in you, you yourself, you will know there is something that is living in you. It always keeps you going. You sleep, when you wake up, you just need to hear one word that comes from God. It gives you again the energy. It keeps you going. If it is not there, you can tell yourself you are just forcing it. Mechanical parts. But God's word is need the Spirit of God. Then when you bring the two together, it keeps you going. It keeps you going. Brother, why you are not tired? The word and the spirit put together, brother, it gives you the energy. You can go all the way. Brother Barili, when we went on his burial, we were told that missionary man, he will go to Africa for 4 months and preach the word one country to another on his way back home. After 4 months, the wife waiting, my husband has arrived. What have you brought? Nothing. No money, nothing. He went just to preach the word. Did you bring any money? Nothing. Because you don't preach for money. You just preach for the souls to be saved. Mm-hmm. But Laodicea today, all the preachings, they are made with an intention to make money. And when the Lord looks at them, the Lord sees them blind. I think Psalm 129. Must have got it right. No, not it's not Psalm 129. I must have mixed up the scripture. Maybe I'll read first. Still, when we are in Isaiah, can we go to Isaiah 44?
No, it's not Isaiah.
Isaiah 44. Isaiah 44. I will go to verse 18. They have not known, nor understood. For he has shut their eyes that they cannot see, and their heart that they cannot understand. And the none considereth in his heart, neither is the knowledge nor understanding up to them. So the one who shut the eyes and the understanding is God himself. Brothers, ask yourself, when we think of Elijah, the Tishbite, that man, he spoke the thus saith of the Lord. The heavens were shut for 3.5 years. There was no rain. Before the rain was falling, it was raining all the time. And then he challenged Ahab. Maybe Jezebel was standing by. He then said to them, listen, there will be no rain, no dew. As in my words, they heard that. And then day one, no rain. Day two, no rain. Week one, week two, week three, week four, no rain. Second month, third month, fourth month, brethren, even yourself, somebody spoke, maybe it did rain the day before, and then there is no even the freshness, brethren. Can't you even yourself come back a little bit and say, okay, that's fine. But please, what that man says, since that man spoke, we've seen that there is no rain coming. Can't we humble ourselves and go to that man and tell him, please, the God you are worshipping is a living God. Can't we just humble ourselves and go to that man? Brothers, God himself had already blinded them. The prophet of Ahab, they were already possessed with a demon of lying. Whenever they go to meditate the word, the way they were understanding it, it was just corrupted already. Because God had already shut their understanding. Brethren, when Jesus said to Peter, it's not flesh and blood, it's my Father in heaven who has revealed this to you, what does that mean to you? When you receive the revelation of who Jesus is, it's not about, brother, you know me, I'm good in maths, you know. Brother, I'm good in English. When I was trying to look at the syntax or the sentence, the verb, the subject, then I've understood. It's not about that. Peter was not educated, but he had a very good understanding of the word. Brother Branham himself, he had a primary school education level, living. He was one of the greatest theologians, but his theology, he could not compete with the prophet. Why? Because the word comes to the prophet. Brothers, do you think a teacher trained by a man, he can teach the word far better than the word that is revealed by God himself? No way. Because the meaning of the word is God who gives it. Going to school, you are trying to figure out what the word means. But now the owner of the word comes, he gives you what it means. That's why the church of God is built upon the revelation of who Jesus is. These believers, they are not like any other believer. That's why, my brethren, we'll get to that point. All the list of things we have mentioned in the age of Laodicea, for you to overcome all of them, you need to have a genuine faith. Faith that is anchored in the word. Faith which is the revelation. You need to have the revelation. Because the faith in itself is a revelation. Without it, one day you will go back in the denomination. You will go there and say, ah, my brother, I could feel the sensation, brother. The presence of God was there, brother. They were really singing, brother. It was moving. Yeah, because you don't have the revelation. As you lack the revelation, even your judgment will never be right. Your judgment will always be wrong. That's why, my brethren, use the word. Take the word. Let the word guide you. Every decision must be driven by the word. Don't let your feelings drive you. Don't let your feelings guide you. No. Take the word. Let nothing blind you. Take the word. When the word tells you there is a danger, don't ignore it. Because we tend to close our eyes when something is on our side. Brother, you know what? It's in on my interest, brother. My well-being. And yet the word is telling you something else. That's why this age, it is an age we are fighting. At times, we are losing even things that could have helped us. But we have no choice. Because the enemy we are fighting, he has disguised himself in a way that you think, brother, everything is all right. Brother, everything is not all right. If you think everything is all right, check again. That's why in this age, the Lord has spoken in a way that, brothers, the precision you've never come across. When it comes to the doctrine, what Paul taught as a doctrine, Brother Branham taught exactly A to Z when it comes to the doctrine. There is no one even example you get, brother, but look here, Paul taught here, Brother Branham said that. No, no, no. What Paul taught is what Brother Branham taught. When it comes to the doctrine, my brethren, you don't even need to worry. You can take the Bible and preach the doctrine of Paul exactly as Brother Branham did teach it. Godhead, water baptism, Lord's Supper, the rapture, the judgment, everything, exactly as Paul taught it, that's the way we are teaching it. But because the world has rejected it, God himself, as it happened in the days of Ahaz, the Lord has sent a strong delusion upon many, so that when they hear, they just can't understand. Even if they see God raising a dead, they will do nothing. If you read what the Lord himself says in Mark chapter 8, Mark 8.
Mark
8. I read from verse 15. Mark 8, 15.
Mark
8. And he charged them, saying, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Aaron. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have no bread. And when Jesus knew it, he saith unto them, why reason ye? Because ye have no bread. Perceive ye not, neither understand. Have ye your heart yet hardened? Having eyes, see ye not. And having ears, hear ye not. And do ye not understand? Or remember, when I break the five loaves of among 5,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? They say unto him, five. And when the seven among, and when the seven among 4,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? And they say, seven. And he said unto them, how is it that ye do not understand? Brothers, these believers, the apostles, or disciples, what the Lord was doing among them, they just took a while. They completely forgot. They could not remember that the Lord took a bread out of few bread and fish. He then prayed, gave thanks, and then multiplied them for thousands of people. But it took just a while. They completely forgot. Their memory, very weak. They wouldn't remember. That's what happened to most of us. The Lord has blessed you. The Lord has given you something. You completely forget. You think, oh brother, you pray for me, brother. I can't make it today, brother. Pray for me. When you were out of work, brother, please pray for me. The Lord has now blessed you to see you in the church. It becomes a problem. Brother, you pray for me. So, which means, for the Lord to get hold of you, maybe it's better when you are out of work. Because when you are out of work, the Lord at least can meet you in the church. Why? Because, no, brother, you pray for me. For how long? Brothers, always remember the goodness of God.
Amen.
Don't forget. Because at times we tend to forget. When things start going well, brother, we become lazy. Very lazy. You even to pray, your eyes, your mind is just on the watch. Brother, we have taken too long today. Brother, we've taken too long. Why? Because there is a program on TV, I need to go and watch. Brothers, we don't spend much time. We have only 2 days per week. But already these 2 days, excluding Sunday, it is a battle. To have you every day, it is already a battle. Now the Lord will ask you, where were you? Where were you? Because don't forget, for you to fight the devil or the demons in this age, you need to know what you are fighting against. And you need to know how the enemy comes. And you need to know how to overcome him. Now, if you don't know how the enemy is fighting, how will you overcome him? Brothers, the devil knows his battle. He knows how to fight. But the Lord, he also teaches us on how to fight him. But now when the Lord is teaching us how to fight, you were not there. It's like people who practice sports. They will do all the techniques during the week. Because they know when you get on Sunday, when it will be the actual game, We've already practiced all our techniques. When they go now in real life, that's the time to apply the techniques you've learned. But that's when the techniques are being given, we are not there. Do you know that even the Lord, there were things the Lord would not speak in public. And then when the apostles will go in a small room, all the disciples, he will then start telling them. So even you don't understand. But how come? Why don't you hear? So you completely forgot what I did. The Lord was rebuking them because they had completely forgotten. Brothers, there is one Antichrist. There are many Antichrists. If you don't know how those Antichrists come, it means you are blind. You need to know. Even if you are preaching the message, brother is reading brochures, it is still not enough. The spirit behind, brethren, I will need to explain it at one point. As a preacher, I need to have a foundation. I need to have a ground. Every action I take, if you come and ask me a question, brother, why did you take such a stand? I need to be able to tell you, based on this scripture, that's why I did what I did. Without such, that would mean today maybe it's because of what I dreamt. No, brother, I've done what I did because of what I dreamt. Tomorrow, no, brother, it was because of a feeling. Brothers, I wouldn't even stay in such a church. Why? Because only the word is infallible. I need to be able to say, brother, based on this scripture, that's why I did what I did. But whereby, no, brother, where the wind blows, I go. Tomorrow the wind blows, it's like today. A false doctrine comes, I embrace it. You believers come to realize, no, brother, that was a false teaching. The preacher is already gone in a false teaching. The members have remained in the sound doctrine. Instead of the preacher to bring the members back, it's the members who are going to pull the preacher back. Brother, you've embraced a false doctrine. Brother, come back. No. I must have the ground, my brother. And the ground is God's word. And by God's grace, with what I saw this weekend, I just said to myself, Lord, please help me. Why? Because, brothers, the day I will preach a false doctrine, brother, it will be a disaster. Not only a disaster, how will I explain it? You know, repenting for having taught something which is not biblical, it's not easy. It needs humbleness of heart and humbleness of spirit. But God is granting the grace. Brethren, be one of them believers who is driven by the word. Don't be a believer driven by emotions. Today, brother, my wife dreamt, brother, I shouldn't go to work. Tomorrow, brother, my wife dreamt, I shouldn't go to work. Three times, the company will sack you. And then, go back now to that wife. So, to give you another dream, to show you where you need to go. Brothers, there are what we call common sense. The Lord said, if you don't work, don't eat. Every man will eat out of his own sweat. Now these dreams, you are dreaming a dream that is even breaking the word. No, brother. You know when you are spiritually blind, brother, you will embrace anything. No wonder there are many divorces going on, because people did not have the revelation of the word. No, that woman, she's not your wife. You just believe it. We don't even check in the word. Before you know it, the person who prophesied, he goes and marry the same woman. Now you find yourself with no wife. Oh no, brother, this man deceived me. Yeah, because you were ignorant. But we thank God for the revelation of the word. If you finally read Psalm 119, Psalm 119.
Psalm 119.
The Bible says, from verse 130. The entrance of thy word giveth life. It giveth understanding unto the simple. 130, yeah? Psalm 119, verse 130. So, in other words, the revelation of thy word giveth light. It giveth understanding unto the simple. You take the word. With the word. Even the way we marry, we take the word. Marry in the Lord. Adopt reason. In the Lord, that's why we find a believer. I don't go to a pub. In England, if you want to find a woman, go to a nightclub. All the people you see there, they are looking for either wife or husband. You go there to look for a wife. Brother, you have met your wife in a nightclub. What convinces you that when she will be in your house, when you won't be there, she won't go there? You don't have an assurance. But we know the word gives the understanding. The revelation of your word gives us the understanding. We take the word, we then follow the footsteps of the word. Brother, we know how to marry. Not because we learned it at school. Because the Lord has revealed it to us. We don't ask for a CV. Can I see your CV? Then I see all the skills you have. Then maybe it can match. No. Is he born again? Is she born again? If somebody is born again, they will pass the test. They are likely to be a good husband or a good wife. But somebody, brother, with all the skills of the world, without the new birth, if you choose such a person, spiritually speaking, you are blind. You may think, brother, me, I see. No, you don't see. You are blind just like Laodicea. That's why, my brethren, by God's grace, the Lord said, because you are blind, I advise you to come and buy of me the eyesight. I think we'll pick that one up tomorrow. We'll see that also in its details. But please, one verse and then we'll pray. In 2 Thessalonians 2, 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 11, the Bible says, and for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. So, if you reject the truth, God will take that responsibility to send a strong delusion upon you, so that you may believe a lie, and then at the end, you may be condemned. That's what, brothers, may the Lord help us. Blindness is one of the bad things. You may be blind naturally. That is in the end of the world. The blindness in the nature or body is not very bad. What is very bad is to be blind spiritually. What God is doing here, you fail to see it. Brothers, such level of blindness is the worst. Why? Because you will even curse what God is doing. You then go and bless what God has cursed. In the days of Brother Branham, brothers, that brother did suffer. When you read the life story of Brother Branham, you know, all of us, you would want people to wish you well, to welcome you, you are part of them. But not in the days of Rabrana. Every revelation that God was giving him was always putting him at odds with people. Everybody was baptizing in the Trinitarian baptism. The Lord revealed to him that the baptism is in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Wow. Including his own pastor. He was baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And the Lord revealed something completely different. What do you do with it? He went to Pastor Davis. Please, let's go, you baptize me. Fine. But when we go for you to baptize me, can you please baptize me according to Acts 2, verse 38? What do you mean? In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet the church in which he was a member, they were baptizing in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He said, but please do me a favor. Baptize me as in the book of Acts. I'm sure when Pastor Davis was baptizing him, his ears must have been widely opened. He wanted to make sure really that the pastor is really calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus. And then he got baptized. When he went out, he then started preaching the baptism in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. People started opposing. No, 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 this is a new movement. People wouldn't accept it. But brothers, because he had the scripture, Brother Branham already at that time, he offered to all the churches $1,000. He said, if somebody finds in the Bible a man or a woman who was baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, he needs to come to me, I'll give him this $1,000. From that time, that challenge is still on. No one has ever come. To say, brother, we have found it, no one has ever come. But as time moved on, one time the Lord came and said to Brother Branham, it was on an open air. He just saw the Lord standing like in the air. Brother Branham looked and thought maybe it was a vision. He took a small piece of tree, cut it. He then realized it was not a vision. He was seeing with his natural eyes. Then a voice came from up that the same Jehovah of the Old Testament is the same Jesus Christ, or the Lord Jesus Christ of the new. Brothers, what an encouragement to just know that the God of the old is the same God of the new. And then the later on, the Lord came and revealed the serpent seed. People say, no, you've gone crazy. This is now madness. Oh no, Cain and Abel, they were twins. How do you know that? Brothers, that revelation in itself did put Brother Branham at odds with people. People abandoned him. But when the seals came, marriage and divorce came, Brother Branham, who used to preach to thousands of people, at the end, Brother Branham started preaching to 100 people, 50 people, 400 people. Brothers, as a human, he could look with his natural eyes, he could not believe what he was seeing. And yet, before God, it had to be like that. Because remember the elect. The elect, my brethren, there is only one thing the elect are after, is the word. Nothing else. An elect, if you want to catch an elect, is the word. You've beaten your wife. Say, brother, don't want my wife anymore. Fine. Okay. When we bring the word to you, the weakness of an elect is the word. If you show them the word, brothers, they are weak. They don't have the power against the truth. The only power and strength they have in them, it's only for the word, not against the word. When you see somebody going with a permissive will, they are not an elect. Brother Frank is writing it in Marriage Ancient Problem and saying, an elect only the pure words. But the so-called, even a permissive will, they can do with it. You are already married. You go, you marry a second wife. You are not in a perfect will. That's not a perfect will at all. And an elect would not do such thing. Because an elect, only the perfect will is what matters to them. Oh, brother, what about David, brother? What about David? Oh, Solomon. David was a king. You are not a king. Solomon was a king. Maybe he could afford it. But you can't afford it. And the good part in England, for which we thank God, polygamy is illegal. It is illegal. If you marry too wide, it is illegal. You can get arrested. One time I was telling a fellow brother in Congo, I said, brother, the good part in our country, meaning in UK, polygamy is illegal. Your husband marries a second wife, if you ring the police, it is a serious case. You will end up in court. Why? Because you can't marry too wide legally. So, to some extent, the law seems to have even helped us. So we can't even preach on polygamy. Because if we preach it on the pulpit, we are breaking the law. Paul says we need to respect even the law of the country. So curse, if he comes, he can't preach. Because he will put us already in conflict with the law of the country. But we thank God. Brethren, if the Lord tarries, we will pick up on this tomorrow. But may the Lord open our eyes. If you read in Luke 24, the two believers on the way to Emmaus, their natural eyes were open. They saw a man walking with them. That man asked them, what has happened? Why are you so sad? They said, wow, are you the only person in Jerusalem who does not know what has happened? That man asked them, what has happened? Oh, you mean you don't know concerning Jesus of Nazareth, whom we thought God has raised and then? Then the Lord looked at them and said, oh man, who was slow to believe what the prophet, the psalm, spoke about. As the Lord was talking to them, the Bible says, he then opened their eyes. They then understood. They then realized that the one who was talking to them was the Lord himself. They then said, didn't our heart burn when he was talking to us? Didn't our heart burn all along? They were completely blinded. Then the Lord opened their eyes. Brothers, the grace of God. When you understand the word, you can go and thank God. You can go and praise God. Why? Because it does not depend on your education. It is only by God's grace. May his name be blessed. Can we just stand and pray as we are led, as time is gone? Let us all pray.